A young couple from Great Falls went on a date on the night of the 2nd of January, 1956. But as the sky grew darker and the air got stiffer, neither of them returned home. They were 16-year-old Patricia Kalitsky and 18-year-old Lloyd Duane Bogle. Patricia was a junior in high school at the time, and although she had only met Duane a month prior at her cousin's wedding, the two appeared to be smitten with one another and would spend quite a bit of time together. Duane and Patricia were last seen alive at around 9 p.m., leaving Pete's drive-in restaurant in the Great Falls area. They then headed west out of Central Avenue to a well-known Lover's Lane located close to Wadsworth Park. Neither Patricia nor Duane was heard from again. Patricia's older sister had eloped when she was around the same age as Patricia was at the time, so her parents had initially assumed she had eloped with Duane. Duane was an airman stationed at Malmstrom Air Force Base, where he had recently risen to the rank of Sergeant Second Class. Here, he was assigned to the 29th Fighter Interceptor Squadron. Upon taking a closer look at Patricia's life and tendencies, they soon grew worried because, although the couple had discussed the idea of getting married, Patricia was hardly the type to elope. She was a diligent student and had high school classes to attend the next day. She also had dreams of going to college once she finished high school. In addition to this, the couple was known to adhere to Patricia's curfew and were not expected to stay out late. Duane was also well accepted by Patricia's family, who considered him to be part of the family. So, all in all, the couple had no reasons to disappear voluntarily. That same night, two women and two airmen drove past a man lying on the ground between a car and a tree. They did not think much of this sighting and just assumed that the man was too inebriated to drive and had simply passed out on the ground beside his car. Had they stopped and checked on the man, they would have discovered that the man was in fact deceased. The next morning, on the 3rd of January 1956, three young boys were taking a walk in the Great Falls area, discovering the remains of 18-year-old Lloyd Duane Bogle. His remains were positioned such that half his body was under his car, with the other half visible outside. Duane had his wrists tied behind his back with his own belt, and he had been shot through the skull. The car's ignition switch was still turned on, and the headlights were turned on. A coronial inquest recommended an autopsy be done on Duane's remains, and while investigators knew he was shot, they were unable to recover the bullet. Investigators were still trying to recover the bullet in hopes that it would give them contextual clues about the perpetrator. During the autopsy, it was discovered that Duane had likely been alive for hours after he was shot. A day later, on the 5th of January 1956, the remains of Patricia Kalitsky were recovered from a rocky ravine about 8 miles from where Duane's remains were found. She was found fully clothed, and her remains were at the edge of a 20-foot embankment just off of a highway around 6 miles northwest of central Montana. Both robbery and sexual assault were initially ruled out as motives, since an expensive camera was found in Duane's car, in addition to a $5 bill that was found in his wallet. There were no signs indicating that Patricia had been sexually assaulted when her remains were first examined. However, during her autopsy, it was discovered that she had likely been sexually assaulted. News articles that reported on the crime only mentioned this in passing, possibly since discussing the topic was not socially acceptable at the time. Although technology did not exist to analyze DNA evidence at the time, coroners still collected a vaginal swab, which they stored carefully for decades to come. They also found several wounds caused by blunt force trauma, indicating that a struggle had likely ensued between Patricia and the killer. That same day, investigators questioned a possible suspect in relation to the killings, which they had described as Chinese-style executions. There is no doubt that this term would not be used today, but at the time, it was far from being socially unacceptable. The personal details of this potential suspect were never released, but it was stated that he was an airman who worked with Duane. Just a few days prior to the killings, Patricia's mother had a conversation with Duane because he seemed visibly upset. She had asked him what was bothering him, to which he responded, "I've got the blues and just can't shake them," before going on to say that he had had an argument with a friend. This suspect was eventually ruled out. In November of 1989, investigators decided to look for the bullet in a tree nearby. In an interview with the Associated Press, Cascade County Sheriff Barry McLody stated, "The tree has always been of major interest to law enforcement officers, because that's where he was killed, right at the tree." The recovery of the bullet used to kill Dwayne would allow investigators to identify the caliber of the weapon used to shoot him, and determine if the bullet is potentially linked to any firearm confiscated in other incidents over the years. Sergeant Dick Duncan stated in the same interview that previous attempts to x-ray the tree were unsuccessful due to the size and density of its bark. The tree was around 80 feet tall, and its trunk was around 4.5 feet in diameter. Investigators planned to shave around 33 growth rings off its bottom half, according to Sheriff McLody. He stated, "Once we hit the 33-year mark on the tree, we should see an entry if the bullet went into the tree, a hole, a tunnel." Hopes of finding the perpetrator were renewed when investigators recovered bullets from the cottonwood tree. However, this hope was short-lived, as the bullets could not be matched to a firearm involved in another crime. While there weren't any substantial breakthroughs in this case, it was never stagnant, and investigators continued to pursue any and all leads they received. As many as 35 people were questioned in connection with the case. One of the potential suspects in this case was Edward Wayne Edwards, who had been arrested in Montana in 1956 for burglary. In 1955, he escaped from Akron Prison and went on a spree, robbing gas stations across the country. In 1961, he was put on the FBI's most wanted list, after which he was caught in 1962. He was subsequently paroled in 1967. It wasn't until 2009 that he was arrested again, and in 2010, he pleaded guilty to killing four people, 29-year-old Billy Lavaco, 18-year-old Judith Straub, 19-year-old Tim Hack, and 19-year-old Kelly Drew. Edwards subsequently confessed to killing 25-year-old Danny Law Glockner in 2011. He also confessed to convincing Danny Boy, who was a soldier in the U.S. Army, to go AWOL. Edwards later shot Danny Boy and buried him in a shallow grave. He was sentenced to death in March of 2011 for his involvement in the death of Danny Boy, but he died in prison just 1 month later due to natural causes. The metaphorical point of connection between Edwards and the Kalitsky-Bogle killings was his MO. Edwards was known to target couples in lovers' lanes, similar to where Patricia and Duane were when they were killed. His crimes were referred to as the Sweetheart Murders. Another suspect in the killings was James Joseph Whitey Bulger, who was a notorious criminal in the area. Bulger had been arrested for sexual assault in 1951. He was known to have been in the area when the killings occurred, but there was no evidence that could prove his involvement. As the years went by with no new leads, the trail for the man who killed Patricia and Dwayne went cold. In 2012, Sergeant John Cadner, the head of detectives for the CCSO, was assigned to this case. In a presentation, Sergeant Cadner stated that DNA evidence from the vaginal swab had been sent to the state crime lab in 2001 by Detective Phil Madison, who was investigating the case at the time. It was proven that the DNA was not Dwayne's and was subsequently entered into CODIS. There had been no matches since then. After being assigned to the case, Sergeant Cadner worked with Bode Technology to recreate the DNA sample. In 2019, they had successfully recreated the sample recovered. This time, in addition to comparing it with the samples entered in CODIS, they also decided to compare it to DNA submitted by members of the public to open-source DNA databases. Open-source DNA databases are used by people who want to conduct independent research into their family trees. Just a year prior, in 2018, the Golden State Killer had been apprehended because members of his family had submitted their DNA to a similar open-source DNA database, subsequently leading to his identification and arrest. The sample uploaded by Sergeant Cadner was compatible with those uploaded by three other people, and investigators got into contact with them and their family members. DNA samples were collected, and it was determined that the most likely match for the DNA sample recovered from Patricia Kalitsky's remains was Kenneth Gould. Sergeant Kadner stated in an interview with NPR, "It was great, because for the first time in 65 years, we finally had a direction and a place to investigate. Because that was all theories until then. We finally got a game, and we got a name. It changed the whole dynamic of the case." They did, however, have another problem. Kenneth Gould had passed away in 2007, and his remains had been cremated. Authorities then reached out to his children and explained the case to them, following which they agreed to submit their DNA for comparison. Investigators were initially skeptical about approaching them, but they were fully cooperative. Sergeant Kadner stated in an interview with the Waco Tribune Herald, "I wasn't sure how they were going to react when I come to them saying, 'Hey, your dad's a suspect in this case,' but they were great to work with." When their DNA was compared with the DNA found at the scene, it matched. Kenneth Gould was a Great Falls native who was known to ride his horses around the Vineyard Road area where Patricia's remains had been found. He lived close to Patricia's parents at one point, but beyond this, he had no connection to either Patricia or Dwayne. When Kenneth Gould was 25, he married a 16-year-old, which is the same age Patricia was at the time of the killings. A month after the killings, Kenneth Gould uprooted his whole life and moved his family to Tracy before moving to Geraldine, then to Hamilton, before finally moving out of the state of Montana to Missouri, never to return. It was finally announced that Kenneth Gould was the most likely suspect in the killings, since he was deceased at the time, and his guilt could therefore not be irrefutably proven without a fair trial. Sergeant Kadner stated, "Obviously, I can't put the gun in his hand, but when you put everything together, there's no doubt in my mind that he's the suspect." Kenneth Gould's daughter reportedly told Sergeant Kadner, "You never know. Some people just have secrets they never told anybody." The families of Dwayne Bogle and Patricia Kalitsky were finally contacted and offered the closure they had spent over 65 years waiting for. While they were happy to finally have answers, the revelation also opened old wounds for the families, especially for the people who were old enough to have known the couple personally. Sergeant Kadner stated, "They are excited, but at the same time, it brought back a lot of memories. You had two young, vibrant individuals that were well-liked among their peer group. Investigators poured their hearts and soul into this case. They leave a little bit of themselves from what I've seen." Patricia Kalitsky's sister, who was the only surviving member of the family, had advanced dementia by the time her sister's killer was identified. The Bogle family had been torn apart for years, with stories about what might have happened to Dwayne, including unsubstantiated rumors that he had been involved with the mob. Dwayne was survived by his niece, Karen Bogle McCarthy, who was 54 at the time. Her father, James Bogle, was Dwayne's younger brother and had idolized him growing up. In an interview with the New York Times, Karen stated, "It's like it just happened yesterday. So if I was asked, is this great modern technology a great thing? I would say, on balance, yes, for my generation, a generation once removed. But it definitely reopens old wounds that have had a chance to crust over." In an interview with KRTV, Edgar Wilson, who was Kenneth Gould's neighbor for 10 years in Missouri, stated, "I can't believe this stuff about Ken. I just plain do not believe it. He was easygoing and soft-spoken. He didn't drink. He didn't raise Cain. I never heard him cuss in my life. Just a real good man." During his time in Missouri, Kenneth Gould lived on a farm with his family, where he raised sheep and goats and was a horse trainer with a stellar reputation. It is impossible to know the motive behind this crime, because the only three people who could potentially shed light on it are all deceased. All we know for sure at this point in time is that, like Kenneth Gould's daughter stated, some people just have secrets they never tell. If you find this interesting, then check out our other videos on similar topics. As always, thanks for watching.